So we have attempted to, you know, streamline all the processes in acknowledgement of the fact that actually it's becoming more and more challenging, particularly with a challenging financial backdrop. Less resources, we need to try and maintain this as best we are able. So absolutely recognise the fact that our staff are contributing to those excellent response times across Merseyside, and I think that's right to acknowledge that point.
Thanks, Robbie. Any more questions? That report noted then. Agenda item 6, which is on page 78, which is the forward where we're
thanks, Chair. Just to obviously bring members' attention to the forward work plan and the particular areas that we are seeking to scrutinise for the March 17 meeting. And again, just I'll relay them and I'll include members from identifying other areas that they would want to scrutinise through the Performance and Scrutiny Committee. But the areas currently identified for that scrutiny are fire control and the mobilisation process. Again, just to kind of go back to the previous report. How we are managing our resources as effectively as we possibly can, how we ensure that we minimise the time between a call being received and our attendance on scene. Implementation of the management review, in particular its impact on partnership arrangements. Members will be aware we've kind of moved from district delivery to functional delivery more recently, and as a result of that we've had to realign and re-establish the partnership arrangements and how we are discharging our partnership arrangements, particularly in areas where we have statutory responsibilities of community safety partnerships, you know, how we influence our health and wellbeing boards and so on and so forth. So that will be a report that comes back to explain what we are doing to ensure that our impact on our communities in a broader sense is being managed and discharged. How effective is our consultation process is another area for scrutiny. Again, we've just coming to the conclusion of a number of significant consultation events that are taking place across Merseyside in regard to the mergers, and we believe now we are in a position to be able to feedback around the consultation process, not necessarily the outcomes, and clearly those mergers haven't come to conclusion, and, you know, and new stations haven't been built in their areas and so on and so forth, but I think we are able to share with you what that consultation process has been consisted of and how thorough that has been for you, again, members, to scrutinise that process. And again, that will come back subject to internal audits, taking a view on that process and reporting that back through, hopefully for March 17th of March 2016, I should say. And then the final area for scrutiny is the implementation of the new HR policies. Members will be aware we've introduced a capability procedure, revised disciplinary procedure, probably some 12 months henceforth previously, and we said to members at that time that we would come back and review and revisit their HR policies to see whether they were having the desired effect in managing sickness absence, being supportive in regards to our staff and so on and so forth. So we will report that back through Performance and Scrutiny on 17th of March 2016, and I'm happy to take any other areas apart from one actually because I've missed it out. Environmental performance, we will also report back on the 17th of March 2016. So there will be a number of reports that will come back around our environmental performance as well as the indications that I've already previously provided. But again, happy to take any additional areas that the members feel are appropriate given the nature of the environment that we're currently operating within.
Thanks, Paul. Anthony?
Chair, I think we should scrutinise the medical emergencies that we've started attending. Whether they are full cardiac arrest or other medical, because obviously it's a project in it for 12 months, so we need to look at it, see what our response is, and how often the crews are responding to it, and the outcomes.
Absolutely agree. If members are content, there will be an appropriate time to do that. It's likely, and again, it's only likely because we've got couple of internal issues that we are resolving now around commencing that activity. It's likely to commence on the 18th of January, at which point 17th of March may be a little early to be able to give you a kind of full and detailed report for you to understand fully the implications to be a party. But if members are content, we will carry that over, and at a point when we have 3 or 6 months worth of data, it will better inform your decision.
kept our own forward plan. So the next time we talk about taking things is 17th of March, if different things will be moved forward to there.
And she is St. Patrick's Day.
Barbie, you can go on there.
That's okay.
Yeah, I'll draw the meeting to a close. Next week, I'll see 17th of March, St. Patrick's Day. Thank you for your attendance.
Thank you, Chip.
And I'll move back to Guy to carry on the presentation.
Nearly at the end of this anyway, just a few more slides to go through. So we've got to the update on planning and building regulations team, which is a new team at headquarters. Apologies, specialised central team. It's been in place 12 months, and that should say 1,500 submissions, not 15, that they've completed, which is a fair mass of work. I think it's worth pointing out that this is our one opportunity to have an influence on firefighter safety at the design stage. And that is really important because under the legislation, we're consultees for building regulations. I think what's really vital for us to appreciate is that consultation can be dealt with in different levels. There's a spectrum from how much we consult. And our argument is we should consult as fully as possible because this is the opportunity for us to have an influence on firefighter safety. And some of the questions that have been asked throughout this last meeting around influence, around sprinklers, this is our opportunity to do it because we cannot dictate, as we used to be able to, that you must have sprinklers. Building regulations have stipulations, but since the fire safety order came in and people have started putting through fire engineered solutions, they can look at other alternatives. And there are a lot of myths out there that put people off sprinklers that aren't established in factual research, but it's a big battle for us. People do not think of the long-term financial benefit over the life cost of the building. When you come to sprinklers, you need one fire, and straight away any savings you've made are minuscule in comparison to what the loss of that building has just cost. And that's just building before you talk about loss of business and everything else. So it's absolutely vital that we continue to focus our resources as part of our risk-based targeting on this area of work, even though we could say, well, do we really need to do that much consultation? So I thought that was worth pointing out. Somewhere else we've made a lot of progress is in terms of electronic submissions. We have that facility now at headquarters. We have a facility. I don't know if you've ever been in our office, but you're more than welcome to come across and have a look. It's very well set up. All the officers on the team have dual large screens, so they can look at plans. We've got a building planning room where they can put the plans up on a large screen like this in order to look at the detail. And actually what we found is, whereas we thought initially it might be a bit difficult because we can't just roll plans out on the table, now with modern technology we can glean far more information than we could have before, so that's a positive for us. But also it meets the government's expectations in terms of a paperless office, it makes us more accessible to people, it means we